you can listen and see we as a community and as a people are not monolithic in thought.
Amen. Absolutely.
We all have various experiences and opinions. And so I respect that, Tommy, so much to the point where I have learned a lot from Senator Graham, and he is exactly correct. We are not in control. And in some instances, we, as Democrats, lost our way. And so in 2010, there was a huge shift. And so the way I view my role right now is not to forget where I came from. And what I mean by that is that I didn't grow up in private school. I went to public school. And so I remember what those experiences were like. I remember what it was like to be raised by a single mom and grow up on pinto beans and cornbread. And on a good day, you had some fatback. And so those kinds of experiences helped shape me to this day. And so when we do have an extreme conservative public policy, which is affecting our everyday lives, I feel right now part of my role is to educate, inform, and to participate where reasonably possible. And so that's what you'll find me doing in this tough economic and tough public policy environment. And so I have cultivated some relationships where relationships can be cultivated. But again, it is our responsibility to bring the information back home so that each of you can make individual decisions that is going to be best for you, your family, and your community. Because, Tommy, if we don't bring back the information, my real concern is that more and more people are going to get hurt. Through public education, through a lack of infrastructure, and through a lack of understanding what is going on with our city. The tax cuts that Senator Graham talked about are very, very real. We are projected to have over $4.5 million revenue shortfall based upon the tax cuts that they gave last year. So I'm telling you now, it's going to get worse before it gets better, because the state is not going to have the revenue that it needs to provide the services that the state is required to provide. And so all I'm saying to you is that we need to be storing up now and preparing ourselves for a different reality as it relates to community and public service. And so I'm going to stop right there, because one of the things that I've learned in doing these community forums is that I always learn more from you than I think you would ever learn from me. And so, Ms. Sarah, I would love for us to be able to hear from you and take some questions from you so that we can give you our perspectives and take on what's going on in this state and then also what's going on in the city of Charlotte. So thank y'all very much for your time and your patience. And again, I thank you for wanting to know and to be informed.
I think the Democrats have. I just disagree with the premise of your question right from the very beginning. I think the Democrats have. I mean, and people who are affiliated with the Democratic Party have. The Moral Monday protest has given voice to issues all over this country and telling people what's happening here in North Carolina. They have spurred interest in terms of community and grassroots organizations all across North Carolina. We got great candidates running for public office all across the state, we won't win either house this year. We'll narrow the gap, and looking forward to 2016, where a lot of voters will be going to the poll. But I just disagree with the premise of your statement that Democrats are lying back doing nothing. We are fighting every day in the General Assembly, losing on every count, but we're putting up a great fight. We're articulating our message. Joe Ford is going to be one of the best senators this state has ever seen. He is always on point in terms of the Democratic caucus, making sure that our message is sharp, pointed, and to the point. So I just disagree with the premise. Now, we will find out if all that is true if we show up to vote in November.
Right. Right.
I mean, all the marching that the Moral Monday folks are doing is great. Can we mobilize and get people to the polls in November and vote? That's the thing. The messaging, all that is fine. Are we going to the polls and vote? Especially here in Mecklenburg County.
Let me piggyback off of what Senator Graham said. I think that one of the things that I noticed right away when I went to Raleigh is that central eastern part of the state gets more information about state public policy than we do in Mecklenburg County. So sometimes it feels like nobody's talking, but in other parts of the state, Ken, they are. And the Moral Monday protest, while I question whether it was a movement or a moment, they have stopped protesting and they've gone out to do voter registration, which I think is going to be key as it relates to what Senator Graham was saying. It's about GOTV getting out the vote to help bring in reasonable or moderate elected officials to bring in reasonable and moderate public policy that will work for the majority of North Carolinians. And so if you're not hearing it, I would suggest that you online, the News and Observer in Raleigh has, under politics, has a column called Under the Dome. And I didn't know anything about it until I went to Raleigh. And so here I am in Mecklenburg County, and that's a falsehood. We are the largest county and we are the largest contributor to the state. And so somehow we get insulated or think that we can do it all on our own. And that's not reality. And it's also not fair to the folks who live here in Mecklenburg County. We've got to continue to put pressure on the folks from Raleigh to do their job. And they're not doing their job and they're not doing it right by Charlotte, which is the largest economic engine in this state. And so we need to recognize who we are as a county and as a city, but at the same time, understand that we are part of a big city.
I agree with Malcolm. I agree with what you're saying. The Moral Monday, and this is just my thought on it. The Moral Monday movement is great. They've caused a lot of issues. But I'm going to be honest with you. The Democratic Party, not only in the state, but here in Mecklenburg County, has an obligation to go out and support their candidates to put that information out there. Now, with that being said, we have some issues at the state and the county level inside the party.
Okay, that's true.
So, you know, it's not about money. Because it is about money, but if we didn't have the dysfunction that we had, and I like to keep things real at this point. If we did not have the dysfunction that we have at the state and the county level here, then the money will flow. So we have to let our supporters let them see us have some type of game plan,
right,
and some type of vision for the party that we want them to support, whether it's by voting for us or by supporting us financially. And so until you do those things, then you're going to continue to have the perception that we're not getting the message out and that we're not fighting, because we are fighting, trust me. It's almost like going and getting a gut punch every day.
Okay.
So that's my spin on it.
According to the North Carolina General Assembly's fiscal staff, it's over $450 million. If you Google North Carolina's projected revenue shortfall, a News and Observer article will come up and you can see. These are not my words, I'm taking this from staff. And that's one of the things, Ken, that gets glossed over, that the reality hadn't set in. And so we're going, and I do believe this, they're going to give teacher raises because of the pressure. All the pressure that they're receiving from across the state. But the question is, how are they going to be able to sustain it? And then if they are, other things are going to have to be cut in order for them to be able to do it. And that's the challenge that they have right now. In order to give teacher raises, something else is going to have to be cut. And I can tell you right now, it's going to be Medicaid. And Medicaid, people are disconnected, Ken. Medicaid is financial assistance for those folks who qualify for medical assistance in our state. And a lot of these people are elderly, disabled, and the blind. And so we're going to help anybody. It should be that group of population in our state. But also, too, you got working people who get up and go to work every day, who only make so much money, who need that assistance. And so there are some tough choices, But again, the choices were made for us last year when they cut taxes in an economy that hadn't fully recovered yet. And I'm not, you know, saying we shouldn't cut taxes. I'm just saying there is a timing in it all. Let's let people get on their feet.
I think it's personalities, and it's politics too. You know, keep in mind, Berger wanted to run for U.S. Senate at one point. Tillis is running for U.S. Senate. Berger doesn't like McCrory. McCrory likes Tillis.
Yeah.
So it's all into, and there is a legitimate disagreement in terms of who's more conservative, right? If you want to win a Republican primary, you have to be very conservative, which means you have to advance conservative policy. And so the governor isn't running for U.S. Senate. He's governor, but he's still a conservative with Art Pope in his hip. So it's a matter of degree, right? The Senate says we're going to give teachers 11% raise, but you got to forfeit your tenure. Right? Makes no sense. Right? The House says we'll give you 5%. The governor said we'll give you
seven.
The governor said 3%.
Okay.
All right, so it's just a matter of degree. Everyone wants to, the governor is finding out that he doesn't run anything. The man with the power in the state of North Carolina is Phil Berger, okay? Who sits quietly by and we talked about this last week, let everybody do his bad bidding for him. And the Tillis is the rock between the hog plate, he's running for in the general election. Now he has become very moderate, and his track record is catching up with him.
That's right.
And Berger doesn't care.
That's right.
Okay, so now Malcolm has taken up most of the time. Okay. So you all just very
quickly, since you referenced the House, there's a vacuum going on, a vacuum of power, because they know that Tillis is leaving as Speaker now. So they're jockeying for a position about who's going to be the next speaker. Also, you have to understand, it's just like the Democratic caucus. You have urban Democrats, you have rural Democrats, and everybody in between. So everybody's looking to advocate for their own interest, their own constituency. So especially when you have that type of thing, you have 77 members that you have to satisfy in the House, then they're going to have infighting because, you know, absolute power corrupts absolutely. So I believe that's what you're seeing, and hopefully we can capitalize upon their division and try to shave some of the seats off of their advantage in 14 and be ready for 16 or the projected 18.
Okay.